Coming up, isotope results reveal the possible origins of the Winfarthing lady. The team visit Drake's Island, the English Alcatraz, and the mysterious invention of writing in remote Rapa Nui. Welcome to Time Team News, your monthly dose of archaeology stories and discoveries from Britain and across the globe. Well, with spring just around the corner, we're gearing up to get back out into the field for more excavations, and we've got some extremely exciting projects on the way. We'll be making announcements about these very soon. So please remember to subscribe to this channel to receive all the latest notifications. And remember, it's thanks to your support on Patreon that makes all this possible. But back to this show now, and I'm delighted to report that we're going to be taking the show in new directions. All thanks to you for tuning in. So here we are, it's episode 7. As usual, we've got some great stories lined up for you. So let's get started. You'll often hear me saying that the best discoveries are made during post-excavation, the process that takes place after the dig back in the lab. A time team evaluation might last 3 days, but often the research continues for many months, in some cases many years afterwards, as various specialists present their findings, informing future research. One technique that's increasingly valuable in understanding people from the past is isotope analysis, as our investigation of the Anglo-Saxon cemetery at Winfarthing in Norfolk demonstrates. Our investigation centred on the burial of a high-status lady whose grave goods suggested clear connections with the Kingdom of Francia on continental Europe. Dr. Sam Leggett of the University of Edinburgh explains how isotope analysis works.
So isotopes are based off the whole sort of premise that you are what you eat. So all of your food and drink and where your food and drink are coming from, when you metabolize, when you break down your food, and it then starts to replace and or make new bits of your body. So those sort of chemical signatures of the environment get locked into your bones and teeth. So it can tell you roughly about the environment and what people are eating, and roughly what the climate was like and what type of geology you were living on. But there's lots of areas in Europe which have the same geology and same climate. So we can narrow it down to those broad parameters, but not this pinpoint on a map.
We sent a tooth and a rib sample of the lady to Dr. Leggett for analysis so that we could tell more about the lady's origins and life. Dr. Leggett's isotope analysis confirms that it's unlikely that the lady grew up in Winfarthing, but the results are consistent with a childhood spent in parts of Francia. Indeed, the geological signature matches the region around the Rhineland.
There's maps that I make that are sort of really educated mathematical guesses where the isotopes sort of match up to known water and geological isotopes. So you have some areas that are completely ruled out isotopically, and you'll see that they're sort of blank. And then there's areas that are shades of sort of salmony orange versus the green. The darker the green, the better the match. And that is just purely based on the isotopes and the statistics. And around Cologne, around the Rhine, there's big strips of green, which means, yes, it's an isotopic match. So I think we're building up this beautiful layer cake of here's some of the material that she was buried with. Here are her isotopes from her childhood. It all matches, which is very rare and very nice for me to kind of get that narrowing down, because isotopes can only take you so far, and it's when we contextualize it with the grave goods. And then, you know, we start to circle in with where the bowl might be from, where the pottery is, the coin pendants, and that narrows us down to areas along the Rhine. And it's quite clear that there are other parts of what then becomes Francia that are ruled out, which also is quite nice as well. So we are really looking at Alemannia and areas a little bit further north up around Cologne and heading towards the North Sea, which kind of gives us the answer to how she hopped over to East Anglia.
The investigation really was a rescue project to help us to understand and characterise an early part of English history before the last remaining traces were swept away by the modern plough.
Once we have encountered a human burial, we have almost a duty to find out as much as we possibly can about them, to give them a kind of new life.
You have to sort of detach yourself when you're dealing with human remains to a certain degree to get the work done. But then when you have the data back and you're able to put this story together and talk to you all about what that all means, I think that is the great privilege that we have and the duty that we have to tell that story and put her life back together and bring that story to the fore. Because without the isotopic information, we wouldn't know, is she local, is she not? How does she look compared to everyone else? It does show you when you have those tiny, tiny little bits of a person, you can tell an awful lot about their lives, which is the magical bit of what we do, I think. Some of the work Helena and I have done have kind of shown some of these amazing female connections that we're just really starting to pick apart in fine grained detail, and Winfarthing will be a big part of that story.
And to hear an in-depth discussion on the post-ex, also featuring Professor Helena Hammerow, an environmental analysis from Naomi Supol, please visit Patreon. In the Pacific Ocean, thousands of miles away from the other nearest habitation, is Easter Island, or Rapa Nui. This remote island is famous for its huge stone statues carved from rock made of volcanic ash, reaching 4 metres in height and weighing around 12.5 tonnes. The island's enigmatic past has long fascinated archaeologists, but one of the puzzles to really mystify researchers is Rongo Rongo, a system of glyphs whose meaning is now lost to time and is yet to be deciphered. Less than 30 examples of this script survive, carved onto wooden tablets and characterised by pictorial representations such as animals and human forms. The script's layout suggests that it's read by rotating the tablet 180 degrees at the end of each line. But it's not clear whether this is fully fledged writing or perhaps a memory aid as part of an oral tradition. There's debate around the origins of the script, whether its development was informed by outside contact or whether it was invented entirely independently by the people of Rapa Nui. The script has no known parallels, supporting the idea of a unique invention. But because some of the tablets are made from wood from trees not native to the island, questions remain of a potential outside influence. Some of the tablets resemble the shape of an oar or paddle, giving rise to the theory that they may have been carved on oars from European or American boats, either through direct contact or through washing ashore as driftwood. The island is so remote that the first recorded contact from Europeans was only in the 18th century. New research led by Silvia Ferrara of the University of Bologna has sought to settle this debate. They radiocarbon dated 4 tablets held in Italy. Of these, 3 came back with a date of 19th century, but 1 gave a secure mid-15th century date, which predates known contact from Europeans and supports the idea of an independent invention. The research has been published in an article by a team led by author Silvia Ferrara in the Nature journal. See the link in the box below. On the way to a recent excavation, some of the team stopped off to visit Drake's Island off Devon's south coast, just a short trip from Plymouth Harbour, where Bear has been using photogrammetry to document the island's archaeology.
Time team crew make their way out across Plymouth Sound. It's a short trip to the mysterious Drake's Island. Visible from land, the island has been off limits for many decades, with local people intrigued by what may linger on the old rock.
We're here neither of us threw up because we're not very good travellers, so we're going to take that as a win for the day. Although we do have to come back.
Oh, yeah, we do.
We'll be right.
The weather might have turned.
Don't say that, Bobby.
Originally known as St. Nicholas Island, it is from here that Sir Francis Drake sailed in 1577 to circumnavigate the globe, a feat completed in 1580. It will be several hours until the boat returns at high tide. Their only means of escape pulls away from the jetty.
Here we are, Drake's Island. Let's see what we're going to see. I'm very excited. I've tried not to read up too much about this because I just want to experience it for itself.
Conflict and defence have defined the atmosphere and appearance of the island. Old stone archways lead up to higher areas through remnants of Napoleonic architecture.
So we've just come off the ferry. We've literally just gotten to Drake's Island. It's crazy. I mean, the only thing that comes to mind for me is like it's got Alcatraz vibes. It's English Alcatraz, I guess. I have no idea what we're going to find up here. And we're going up this already immediately foreboding staircase. And there's a sign here that says keep out. So let's not and let's go in.
Several old buildings are clustered to the west side of the island, including the abandoned ablutions building, barracks block, and officers' quarters. World War II was an active time on the island, as nightly Nazi bombing runs flattened areas of the city. These days, the empty ruins are the victim of time and decay, as the new island custodians valiantly uncover and clear more of the island than ever, a huge endeavour which is fascinating and quite eerie to experience firsthand. On the summit of the island, several huge objects are waiting to be 3D scanned. The RML's large rifle muzzle loading guns date from the 1870s and make an unusual sculpture garden. Bear also scans King George II's cannon from 1750, marked with the King's cipher. The intention is to create highly detailed models ready to be studied and added to the island's rich catalogue of virtual treasures. Further conflict saw the installation of gun batteries, tunnels and defences as the technology of war evolved. The island was also used as a prison during the Civil War, the death place of leveller Robert Lilburne and John Lambert, imprisoned for the regicide of Charles I. Isolated islands are effective places of incarceration, but it is unknown how many were imprisoned or died on the island. To wander Drake's Island today is to walk through several centuries of history, where wood was replaced with stone and stone replaced with concrete. Sea mines, sentries and searchlights were installed to guard the naval docks of Plymouth. On the east side of the island, the casemates are gun positions of multiple eras, Napoleonic onwards.
Kind of looks like Corvids or something. It's an armor.
Oh, you found another one. We've got a whole animal yet. I said to him, we're going to get you a finds tray already.
Each chamber is different to the last, with some period metal machinery and woodwork still evident to this day. The crew enter the island's infamous tunnels. The tunnels are a warren of passages from various time periods throughout the island's 400-year history of war and defence. Some are narrow brick passageways like rat runs from one room to the next, whereas others turn sharp angles to small rooms and ammo lifts. The largest chambers are the shell and cartridge stores, part of the underground magazines. The walls are painted with flames and grotesque imagery, a remnant of when the cavern-like space was used as a club with cinema and Friday night disco.
And this comes back out.
The arrival of the high tide meant it was time to leave the island. The pickup was most welcome. Time Team will return another day to continue capturing, recording, and 3D modelling the many layers of history and heritage on Drake's Island.
What a magical place. Would you like Time Team to return to Drake's Island for more investigation? Let us know in the comments section below. One of the big fixtures on the UK archaeology calendar is Current Archaeology Live, a conference and awards ceremony showcasing the best of British archaeology. This year's event was held at the end of February at the University College London and just happened to feature Time Team's very own Dr. John Gator as the keynote speaker.
Welcome, John, to the stage.
So we went along to catch some of the action.
Tony Robinson and geophysics boffin John Gator examined the achievements of geophysics and put the latest technology to the test. Can it distinguish between a bike and a toilet? 18 years I'd been doing geophysics, a chance to have an hour-long program to explain how geophysics works, and this is the level that we're portrayed at.
Lots of old Time Team friends were in the running for awards. Congratulations to the Ness of Brodgar for its double whammy, winning the Research Project of the Year award, with Site Director Nick Card announced as Archaeologist of the Year.
Well, I'm a bit of an imposter here. My second persona is Nick Card. Not Nick Card once, but Nick Card twice.
And it was actually a hat trick for Orkney, with the Knoll of Swandro winning Rescue Project of the Year.
No, really, really pleased because it is such a recognition of rescue archaeology, of Orkney archaeology, of archaeology from Bradford.
Book of the Year was Doggerland by Luke Amkroos and Sasha van der Vaart Verschoef. Big congratulations to all the nominees, highlighting the wonderful wealth of archaeology going on at the moment. And finally, perhaps an Easter-related story for you now. A 1,700-year-old chicken egg has been discovered with the liquid yolk and egg white still inside it. The egg, which was laid way back during the Romano-British period, was discovered during excavations of a Roman site in Aylesbury. A recent scan revealed that the contents of the egg were still intact. A spokesperson for Oxford Archaeology said, "It is absolutely amazing. It may be the oldest egg of its type in the world." Well, that's all for now. As usual, all the 3D models featured in this month's show are available over on our Patreon channel. And remember that Time Team News is also available as an audio-only podcast, so you can listen while you're on the go. And please do keep letting us know about what stories you'd like to see featured in this show. So thank you for watching, and I look forward to seeing you next time.
Join Time Team on Patreon to access exclusive 3D models, masterclasses, and behind-the-scenes insights.